To Ty-Gwyn's online service. We trust you're keeping well during this time of lockdown. Over the past week, we've been praying for those who were unwell, those who were isolated, and we have seen answers to prayers just in this past week. As a church, we're going through our values, and today we're going through being generous. During the Bible in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 9, it says this: "Whoever has a bountiful eye will be blessed, for he shares his bread with the poor." And we're going to hear a little later on from Lloyd about being generous. And we know that God's going to bless us through Lloyd this morning. However, we are going to start with worship this morning. I'm sure many of you on various social media outlets have seen the song, The Blessing. And it's gone viral this week. when a number of churches and denominations have got together to sing this beautiful song. The words go, "The Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face to shine upon you." And if you're going through a difficult period at this moment, just enjoy worshipping God this morning, because the Lord is going to bless you and the Lord will keep you, and trust in him today.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.
The Lord turn his face toward you
and give you peace.
Second guessing, we know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. Your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. And your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you. Children, and the children, may his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going, in your weeping, and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you.
He is for us.
He is for us.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and
that our hair is getting longer and some of the men's beards are beginning to grow. This was me a few weeks ago. Fortunately, I've had a shave since then. I was beginning to think that I might look like this by the time we go back to Ty-Gwyn after lockdown. Then I began to wonder, what would our senior leader and his wife look like, Ivan and Rian? As you can see here, the couple in the regalia, handsome couple as they are. Perhaps Ivan would change something like this, because his hair doesn't grow much. Or maybe something like this. Who knows? And then Rhian, what would she look like? She'd start like this. Would her grey roots begin to show through? Or possibly would she look like this when she comes back? I don't know. Anyway, all I know, the next time I see Rhian, she's going to kill me. We have some wonderful news. There's a new addition to our church in Ty-Gwyn, and you'll see a little video about that soon. But I've also asked some of our parents in the church if they would be willing to chat how it's been for them during lockdown.
Hello, this is baby Warren. She was born on Monday, no name yet. Thanks for your prayers. We'll let you know when we name her. Bye!
Morning everybody. So Alan asked what it's like to be a parent in lockdown, and so I thought I'd give you a little taste of that just by showing you the state of my living room at the moment. So we've got some Mr. Men books down here. Somebody's been reading those. And then we've got some jigsaw puzzle pieces here. That's two different sets of jigsaw puzzles, which is fun. And over here, just lots of random books and toys. There we are. So yes, what I immediately thought of was the fruit of the spirit, and Alan asked that question. It's all about love, patience, kindness, self-control. Yeah, so it's definitely a lesson in all of those. Bye everybody. Bridget, say bye-bye.
Hi, my name is Tammy. I have a little boy named Jaden who's nearly three. Yes, I'm sitting in my car. That is because it's the only place I can go where Jaden can't find me. I'm currently at home all the time with Jaden because I'm on furlough and so not working. And I do miss this intellectual stimulation of my job, but then I'm also just really grateful that I've got the time to focus on Jaden and not try and fit in my work hours as well. I think the way that God's helped me during this time is with a peace that surpasses all understanding. I am a planner and I like structure and routine, and at the moment I don't have any of that and I have no control. But despite the fact that I don't know if I'm going to have a job to go back to or when I'll next get to see my family in South Africa, I still feel remarkably peaceful, and it's a peacefulness that surpasses understanding, and I think that that is God's gift to me during this time. I also now know every name of every character in Paw Patrol, and I'm pretty sure that that'll come in use at some point. Cheers.
Thank you, ladies, for showing how God is keeping you during this time. Let's just listen to Lloyd and God's word this morning.
Morning, everyone. What a joy it's been this week to prepare this talk. I've personally been challenged and learned so much, and I hope I can encourage and challenge you the same this morning. We're talking about generosity. Over the last few weeks as a church, we've been going through our values, and this week I have the privilege of talking about generosity. Look, to start, let's play a game. If you're on your own, write it down. If you're with others, share it out loud. But what's the first thing that comes to mind when you hear generosity? Go on, be quick. First thing that comes to mind, generosity, what's there? For me, I hear generosity, my mind almost simplifies it. I think acts of kindness, and straight away right now, as I say generosity, I think of Captain Tom. I think of him on his Zimmer, walking around his home. His act of kindness, drawing out the generosity of many others, a great cause benefited from his act. We're going to be looking at a section of a letter today written by a man named Paul. It's found in the New Testament of the Bible. It's a personal letter. It's a letter Paul wrote to believers of Jesus in a place called Corinth. There are two chapters, and in the middle of what we know as his second letter, Paul's writing and he's encouraging generosity. I'd love to. I'd love to read the whole thing to you right now, but I fear you'll probably switch off or fall asleep by the end. But can I encourage you, after this, if you've got a Bible, go to 2 Corinthians, chapters 8 and 9, have a read. If you don't have a Bible, Google 2 Corinthians, chapters 8 and 9, and read the whole chapters. It'll really help you understand the wider context of where we are focusing today. Look, in short, chapter 8, Paul, he's encouraging the people in Corinth to give to help others. He says, look, give in proportion to what you have. That's something Paul urges. He's like, whatever you give is acceptable. Don't you hear me saying, Paul says, you should make life hard for yourself and easy for others. But if you have got something that can help others, give generously. And then chapter 9, in the previous few lines before we pick it up, he goes, look, I know I don't really need to go over this with you, because last time I was with you, you were so eager to give. In fact, I've shared your willingness with others, and it's really stirred them on, it's spurred them up to give too. He said, I hope you're genuine, mine, because I'm sending the boys around to pick up what you said you'd give, and it'll be really embarrassing if it's not ready. And then we're into chapter 9, lines 6 to 15. They were read out for us earlier. And just to help us out, I've split them into three sections this morning. As we look at generosity, 6 and 7, we're going to look at our part. 8 to 11, we're going to look at God's part. And 12 to 15, we're going to look at the reward. So hopefully we understand Paul's angle, his agenda. He's encouraging those readers to give generous towards the needs of others. Generosity, it's more than cash. Generosity is more than just giving money. I want you to understand that as we go through together today. As we walk through these lines and grapple and understand, I want you to understand generosity covers everything. Please don't switch off and think, typical, I tune into a Christian talk and here's the guy, surprise, surprise, talking about money and giving money. No, generosity speaks of what we have to give, which is more than cash. It covers our time, our abilities, our possessions, and yes, our finances. So when we talk about being called to be generous, when encouraged to acts of kindness, when stirred to give, it can be so different for everyone. To some, it's giving time generously to help others. To others, it's using our abilities to help. Some, it's giving what we have. And yes, to some, it's the giving of our finances. It can be all of them, one of them, a mixture of them. As in COVID-19, it's been great. It's shown us the reality of this, how beautiful to see people, communities, organisations coming together, bringing what they have to give to benefit others. See, for some it's time, giving their time right now to stay at home and playing their part. Others, it's using their abilities, essential workers called to use what they do to help others. Others, it's what they've got at the moment to give. Food, masks, practical things, the list goes on. And others have been very kind with their money. The question is, are you generous? Are you generous with what you have? And what can we learn from Paul's letters to the believers in Corinth today? So look at line 6 and 7 with me. It's our part. Remember this, Paul writes, a farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop. But the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. You must each decide in your heart how much to give. Don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. It's quite a simple formula Paul gives, right? One we've heard, one we can understand. He uses the illustration of the farmer to help make his point. Put a few seeds in, you get a little crop out. You can plant generously and expect a generous crop. But, you know, don't expect much if you're not putting in much, right? That's what Paul's saying here. But look at line 7. Don't give because of external pressure, he says. Don't give because you feel like there's an expectation on you. Don't even give if you're not happy about it. Recently, I read a post about the young girl Greta who gave £100,000 towards the fight against coronavirus. Fantastic. But this is what the headline read. How many teenagers would give £100,000? And I thought, are you serious? How many teenagers have got £100,000 to give? If that's the mark of generosity, well, we're making others feel inadequate about what they can give. What we actually read tells us, you yourself must personally decide if you're going to give, how you're going to give, and what you're going to give. For this is the point. To God, our attitude when we give is more important than the amount we give. Our attitude when we give is more important than the amount we give. Remember what Paul mentions in chapter 8. Whatever you give is acceptable if you give it eagerly, openly, and willingly. It's about our heart, he mentions. In 2015, I remember visiting a church in Uganda, and it came to the part of the meeting where people were encouraged to give. Now here in the Western culture and Western churches, we got money. But they grasped a biblical understanding of giving and generosity. I'll never forget it, and it's taught me a lot. See, the bowl went around, and yes, there were some that gave money because they had money to give. But around the poverty, some didn't. And I'll never forget someone putting a chicken tied up in the bowl. I was like, am I actually seeing that? Someone's put a chicken in the collection bowl. How beautiful, Laura. They give what they had in order to be generous towards others. What do you have? What time do you have? What abilities do you have? What are your possessions? What are your finances? Where can you be generous to help others? That's our part. We're called to give. We're called to be generous. We're called to individually decide. And we're called to grasp that what we give is what we can expect to get. Now come with me then to lines 8 to 11. Let's look at God's part. Paul writes this, and God will generously provide all you need. Then you'll always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. As the scriptures say, they share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever, for God is the one who provides seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. In the same way, he will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. Yes, you'll be enriched in every way, so you can always be generous. And when we take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God. What's it tell us? It tells us that God will provide what we need. We will always have everything we need and enough to share with others. First hashtag of the day, those who know me, is a motto of mine anyway. Hashtag need not want. Write it down if you're on your own. Say it out loud to the person you're with. What I need, not what I want. It's something I live by. If I'm going to purchase something, if I'm looking to spend something, do I need this or do I want it? See, there's a humongous difference in what God's promise here is to us. Not I want a new bike and the Bible says God will give it to me. I want another pair of shoes. I want, and finish the sentence yourself. British and Western culture, right? I want, I want, I want, I want, I want. And when we don't get it, we have a poody. We sulk, we blame others, or maybe we blame God for not making it happen. How dare you, God, not give me what I want. Here we see the reality of what the Bible says about us. Boy, we are so self-centered. Life is about me. You will always have what you need, God tells us. But see, so often what we need is not what we want. So we ignore and we dismiss the daily blessings and provisions of God. We reject the part God's playing to help us help others. And Paul brings us back to the farmer. He brings the picture around. He says the seed that the farmer plants, however much he decides to plant, comes from God in the first place. So if it's been given to him, why is he being so tight with it? Because it's from God and there's more from where that came from, if it's God's. Again, it highlights our default viewpoint on life, right? This is mine. This is mine and it's for me and I'm holding on to it. And everything I can have is to benefit me and it's for myself. Another truth exposed to us in the Bible, we are naturally selfish. Building ourselves up to be okay. I'm really turning into a TV speaker now. I'm talking about money and I'm going to plug a book. But seriously, I'm looking at Ecclesiastes at the moment in my own time and I'm reading a great book alongside it called Destiny by David Gibson. And this is what it says on the back, and you can imagine how challenging and how good the book is itself. It says this: only a proper perspective on death provides a true perspective on life. Living in the light of your death will help you live freely, wisely, and generously. It will enable you to relish all the small things in profound ways. We must grasp what God's story tells us. Life is a gift to us. Every breath, every day, every good thing is a gift from God above. We're not guaranteed anything. Nothing is ours to claim and be selfish over. All things are from him and for him. Yet how much have we strayed away to think, no, life is mine. I deserve life. Everything I have, I deserve. Everything I want is for me. And we chase different goals and different dreams. But in the end, whether we achieve or not, what's the same for all of us? We die. So whether one farmer sows generously or one sows a little, they both die, right? But both have been given seed by God. And both have a choice how they're going to use that seed and enjoy it before death. As God gives the farmer more seed, Paul says, it's not so this farmer benefits and has loads of personal seed and better off than others. But look at what Paul says. God will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. When God increases your resource, when you get more time, when you gain and grow in your abilities, when what you have increases or you see financial increase, it's so you become more generous. That you give more time, more of your abilities, possessions and finance. But that's not the case with us, right? No, what we get given, we use to become kings and queens of our own lives, to build our own empires. Line 11. Paul says, you will be enriched in every way so that you can always be generous. And when we take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God. Now read it with me and see how our minds have moved the full stop. Yes, you will be enriched in every way. Hallelujah, God. Praise Jesus. That's his promise to me. I will be enriched every day. I'm going to claim it. I'm going to live in that truth. God exists to enrich me. No, that's not where the full stop is. You will be enriched so that you can always be generous. You are a funnel, not a bowl. That's the next hashtag for today. Hashtag funnel, not bowl. Write it down or say it out loud to the person you're with. Funnel, not bowl. Understand this. As God gives increase, whether it's time, ability, possessions or finance, it's not for you to store up, but for you to be continually generous and that it flows through you to benefit others. Can I be honest with you? I'm happy for pushback. I'm happy to even grapple and discuss with this with people that I may offend. In the last season, I've mentioned, look, it is a joy. I encourage you and I'm so glad to see people, communities, organisations all coming together and being generous with what they have to benefit others. I'm not going against it. I've got nothing against it. As we've read, each person must individually make a decision in their heart about what they will do and not be pressurised by others. But I do feel it's exposed another flaw in our character. You ready for the third? We can already see that we're self-centred and selfish. And the third is, we desire to be praised. Because if our motivation is pure, why do others need to know about our generosity? Can't we give a plate of food to someone these days without taking a selfie? Can't we do something kind and generous without posting it on social media? But if we did that, well, nobody would know about our generosity, would they? And it wouldn't count. Of course. And if we did that, well, we wouldn't be praised, would we? And our ego couldn't be inflated. So no, I'm going to have to take a picture and post on social media about every act of kindness I do so that I'll be praised and I'll feel good about myself. It's nothing new, guys. It's existed from the beginning of humanity. We are people who think life is all about us. Now here's the point. We've yet to cover four amazing words in line 11, and they tell us what should happen when we are generous with what God gives us. They will thank God. Do you catch that? They will thank God. They will thank God. They will thank God. What? Yeah, you're hearing it right. We give generously to help others. No, we don't get anything from it. God will get the thanks. And you might be thinking, you're kidding me? You're encouraging us to be kind and generous and not receive any praise from it? We're self-centred. We're selfish. We're seeking praise. And maybe the Bible is right about us after all. But God is the giver of all we have, of our lives, of our time, of our abilities, of our possessions, of our finance. So when we give to others what's been given to us, surely the original giver should get the praise, right? Surely it's only right that God gets the thanks. Because we're funnels, not bowls. So if you haven't switched off or been offended yet, let's finish. We've seen our part when it comes to generosity, God's part. Let's see the reward in lines 12 to 15. Paul emphasises the rewards of giving. And he writes this: two good things will result from this ministry of giving. The needs of the believers in Jerusalem will be met, and they'll joyfully express their thanks to God. As a result of your ministry, they'll give glory to God for your generosity to them and to all the believers. They'll prove that you're obedient to the good news of Christ. And they will pray for you with deep affection because of the overflowing grace God has given to you. Thank God for this gift, too wonderful for words. The reward from giving generously is not increased health and wealth. There is no promise of that in the Bible, and the news of the prosperity gospel is false and biblical. We should not expect to get wealthy from an obedience to generosity and giving. Paul's letter in the Bible, it doesn't offer an investment plan for you with high returns. Here's the reward for your generosity, Paul says to them. First, the needs of others will be met. Second and third, they will joyfully thank God and God will receive the glory. And fourth, what you can expect, they'll pray for you. Now, if you're listening this morning, as I encourage you to seek your own heart right now, in your own generosity, only you can decide what it looks like for you. Don't be pressured, don't give unwillingly. And if you're stirred this morning to give your time, your ability, your possessions or finances to something that's on your heart, it may be to the work of Ty-Gwyn, here's what you should expect from your giving. That the needs of others will be met, that God will be thanked, and God will receive the glory, and you will be prayed for. Look, the church, like every organisation for generations, has mishandled, manipulated, and mistreated the generosity of others. But we've gone back to the source today, to what the Bible says, to Paul's letter to these believers in Corinth. And what he was saying is, look, give generously through the church, not to the church. Do you catch that? That's the final hashtag this morning. Through, not to. Hashtag through, not to. Write it down again. Say it out loud to the person you're with. Through, not to. Can I encourage you? Look, those that lead church have a responsibility to be stewards over what's given. They'll be accountable for that. But as the church encourages generosity, as the church encourages giving, I want you to understand, it's not saying give to the church right now so it can fill its bowl. It's saying be generous and give through the church right now so that people can receive the blessings and resource that God has provided. Be generous. Be generous and be challenged. But maybe this morning, before I close, as we've looked at a section today, you may have been convicted by what's been said. Your self-centeredness, your selfishness, your desire to be praised may have really hit you. You may have been challenged by what it is to acknowledge God as the giver of life, as the giver of all things and everything in it. And you might realise you really hold on to everything tightly. But look, you're not alone. The Bible tells us that all of us, what we want is in rebellion to God. But as we've read, God provides what we need. And what we need is a perspective on life, to understand who we are and who God is. A perspective on death, that we're all going to die and God will judge our lives. We need a perspective on our need, that we're hopeless, but God has given hope. Maybe this morning, as we've looked at generosity, as we've spoke of God and his ways, you may not know him or you may feel really distant from him right now. You're self-centered. You're selfish. You live to be praised, to be the king and queen of your own life. But can I tell you, in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. That is the hope that God gives. That is the need that God has provided for. That we can know the forgiveness, love and security that comes from a restored relationship with God through Jesus. Jesus came outward focused. Focused on you. Focused on meeting your need. And he went to the cross unselfishly. He took the punishment of rejecting God from you. And he invites you to place your faith in him, to open your heart and to receive him this morning. And you can know the transformational love, forgiveness and hope that is found in Jesus. The old gone, the new has come. No longer living for your praise, but now living that God would be praised and glorified. Let me finish with Paul's last line, number 15. Thank God for this gift, too wonderful for words.